No, 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 no.
Santa!
Oh, please don't make me
Santa!
'Cause I just got to heaven
Santa!
Gonna walk come, little David,
Santa,
with his rock and sleigh.
Santa,
I don't want to meet him.
Santa,
he's a dangerous man.
Meet Lylia Fedd. She's a retired resident living in Tallahassee, Florida.
And I learned a lot of them on.
She refuses to sit down. Lylia wakes up as early as 5 a.m. and begins her day around 6. Shortly after sunrise, she is already in her yard feeding her pets and cultivating her crops.
I'm making a pool of pie. Navajo, cabbie leaves.
Since early childhood, crops have been a part of Lila's life. Before her 50-year stint in the service industry, Lylia Fedd lived her life as a sharecropper. Perhaps her routine is nothing short of second nature. About 27 miles east of Dothan, Alabama. Her family were tenants on a farm owned by John Crooks, a white Southern farmer. Lylia was born to a family of 12 children. As each sibling grew to the age of 8, they would have to work alongside their mother and father from sun up to sun down harvesting crops. In theory, the tenant farmers were to be compensated for the crops they harvested and picked. In reality, that was rarely the case. The system of sharecropping formed shortly after the Civil War and the Emancipation Proclamation freed Southern slaves. From the end of the war up until the late 1890s, Southern states had no official public policy on labor or where African Americans should fall in the labor system. Southern farmers were in desperate need of a new society of agricultural earnings that didn't include free labor. Northern workers were fearful of competition with newly freed slaves for work, and Northern capitalists saw the need for continued cotton production. As a result, African Americans, along with the poor, were coerced virtually into re-enslavement.
The oppressor almost never abandons the oppression. They move from one form of oppression to another form of oppression.
There is a serious collapse of social structure. And sharecropping came out of that. And so what happened was, wealthy people offered a certain amount of land to people that had worked for them for free. But with a catch, of course, and the catch was to keep working because they needed that labor.
While some left the South for a chance at more industrial jobs in the North, most Southerners were a rural people who felt land was vital. The planter class dominated the South. Developing land was what they did.
Just because on paper people were granted some new privileges didn't mean that they changed that much psychologically, because they were conditioned to be dependent. They were conditioned to letting other people make decisions for them. They were conditioned basically to being provided for.
Morning before the sunrise, get a little breakfast and go on until lunch and come in and get a dinner before we could eat and go back 1 o'clock, go back to the field till the sundown, and there'll be something whole year round in that field.
Augustine Johnson, a former sharecropper and neighbor to Lylia Fedd, continues to live as a resident of Jakin, Georgia. She remembers all too well the long hours invested working the fields.
Meals will start from December and open till January and February time to plant. They would be done broke the land. They didn't have tractors like they had now to break the land. They had mules.
Lylia and her siblings only attended school 4 months out of the year. According to her, John Crooks required every member of her family to help harvest the crop. During the harvest season, Lylia and her siblings would have to leave school for months to pick what they called the money crops, cotton, corn, and peanuts.
We didn't go to school until November.
After slavery, freedmen expected 40 acres and a mule, but had to settle for a portion of a farmer's land. No serious or immediate action was taken on the part of the government to compensate African Americans for generations of unpaid labor.
They did not recognize that their real situation was that they had been put into a disguised form, another form of servitude. And as long as they didn't see their condition as a continuing of servitude, they would regard that as a good for them.
The federally run Freedmen's Bureau convinced freedmen to sign labor contracts with plantation owners. While these contracts were presented as a fair agreement between a landowner and tenant farmer, laws known as the Black Codes Pigeon held African Americans to a position of social and economic inferiority.
And if we didn't get up proper, grab us by the foot and pull us out on the floor, we had to get up. When he said get up, you had to get up.
The Black Codes were discriminatory laws passed on the state and local level that limited the civil rights and liberties of the black and poor by controlling their labor, movement, and activities. Southern governments adopted vagrancy laws, anti-enticement codes, and a crop lien system trapped African Americans into a sharecropping system. The crop lien system in particular created a cycle of poverty.
Sometimes we wake late and be so sleepy until we lay on the floor and go to sleep. Mama wake us up, wanted to come in cook. 7, 8 o'clock at night and they keep trying to cook. And that wouldn't be nothing but maybe some flour bread and some meat.
Under the crop lien, the landowner would offer a tenant family credit at the beginning of the year in exchange for work on the land. Somehow, many families always seemed to come up short.
And at the end of the year, how many bales of cotton you made, how many peanuts, as a white man would do. Oh yeah, 200 you got. And you had a paper, I don't know what they call it again, but they call it paper, not. Let me call it a notebook now. They would sit it down for what you got during the year. You had to get your stuff on the credit. And then when the end of the year come, we gonna have a settlement tomorrow or the next day. They meet together and they would take all the money from it. You had to work another year back in debt for nothing. You come out, bring it back out in debt.
For many Southern sharecroppers, a corrupt labor system was the least of their worries.
Somebody, they looked at him, he didn't play. They looked at him, he said he hawked his spit in his face. When he hawked his spit in his face, he had his pocketbook and got his knife and stabbed him. Got him through the blade bone back in. He like him about a quarter inch going to his heart. And Lord, they raided that night. Oh, a lot of me be scared to go to bed, be scared to go to bed. Be snatching him, snatching the cap off us, you know, going home. Open the door, we thought that was him. I think me and Lila be one. Knocking on the door, going, let him in. We opened the door, that was the police.
Through social terrorism, such as threats from the Ku Klux Klan, the white planter class was able to gain and preserve political and economic control, further extending the turmoil of racism and oppression.
And some 8 cars behind me, they got a high heel shoe on their feet and a low heel shoe. I see it on the picture, I ain't seen it, man. They got the eyes cut out and the nose cut out, you know. And they would get out there. When they would get out there, and all of them, they sat there across the fire, right in front of them. And they marched around there, they said so many times. And when that cross burned down, you better be gone. And people, black folk, were running and flying like almost like birds. Like all across the woods out there, when you see and look through the one here, somebody there, you better go. They gonna come, they gonna eat you up.
Now the black woman had an ear farm child. And the white woman was praying. She told the black woman, if she had a daughter like that, she would kill the daughter. And God figured she had one come just like her.
In 1910, 89% of the black population lived in the South, 73% lived in rural areas, and of them, only 23% owned land, a total of more than 15 million acres. For Lylia Fedd's father, owning land would never happen, not by force, but by choice.
$1
Yeah!
Damn.
And when the mom couldn't do nothing because she's having all them children. She couldn't do nothing.
By the 20s, nearly 500,000 African-American workers left the South for industrial opportunities in northern cities. In the midst of the 1930 Depression, an underground armed movement erupted. An organized alliance of tenant farmers known as the Sharecroppers Union, created by the Communist Party of the USA, formed in an attempt to demand rights for sharecroppers. By 1936, the union expanded to include over 12,000 members throughout the Deep South. Members endured murderous attacks from mobs and sheriffs. Some sharecroppers fought back, resulting in casualties on both sides. In 1944, Lylia felt she had had enough of the farm life.
The man told her, said, y'all ain't cleared nothing, but I'll give you $100 to start off next year. Me and Clyde told him, I said he can keep it, because I'm gone, and I come to Tallahassee.
Frustrated with her own hampered situation, Fedd left the farm with everything she had.
Bought a bag of dried peas and a 2-pound bag of meal and some white bacon meat, and that's what we ate until we got a job.
Technological changes also forced the migration of many sharecroppers. Tractors and advanced irrigation systems took the place of human toilers. Where it took a hand laborer 74 hours to pick an acre of cotton, mechanical pickers could do it in 6. Between 1920 and 1930, 700,000 African Americans had migrated away from the farm, and by 1960, that number rose to 1.4 million. After 3 centuries of an agricultural lifespan, the southern system of sharecropping had more or less ended, driving 3 million impoverished farmers into America's cities in search of industrial jobs. As for Lylia, when she moved to Tallahassee, she brought with her a work ethic that has stood the test of time. She worked for 25 years as a domestic maid. She then moved into the food service industry, where she worked another 20 years. And while her father may have not seen the importance in having his own land, Lylia worked hard to become self-sufficient. A 40-year homeowner, Lylia grows crops in her own backyard and on a second plot of land that houses her garden.
Well, I know how the planting went on, because we used to do it, up home and all around. Yeah.
She is just one example of many who struggled through trials for decades, but found a way to triumph, survive, and thrive despite life's adversities.